to specifically acknowledge and commend Dr. Femi Ogunsoya, the convener of SworteTalks. And it's important for me to do that in a country where the rich people have mastered the art of making sure that the rest of us do not go past enjoying the privileges and the commonwealth of Nigeria. So in a country where the rich people sit on one side and the poor people are on the other side, and the rich people don't care about the rest of us, when someone puts our money where our mouth is, and is not just sitting in a privileged home discussing the problems, but puts our money on, you know, putting together an important conversation for the next generation of Nigeria at over 70, I think she deserves a round of applause. In addition to that, this is Mola Shadi Adefusayo, Akishaye, all the other smart, brilliant people that have worked with Dr. Kofia to put this together. My name is Toyosi Akerele-Ogunsiji. My friends call me Oluwa Toyosi of the Most High. And forgive me if my tone and language this afternoon would be slightly unsettling. You've got to be assured that it's a needed discomfiture, especially because I'm 34, I grew up in a country where there's two generations of young people in Nigeria today. The worst will be YSA generation. And generation, you guys know what I'm talking about, the science student generation. And the other young people, educated, privileged, some of you who go to schools where they're air conditioned, and your teachers actually teach you in English. Not teach you English in Yoruba language. I'm a first child of four children. I'm a girl, as you can see, but I'm sure that if I was speaking in a room full of darkness, you'd assume that I was male. And that's fine. I grew up in secondary school where boys used to laugh at me, and every time that I spoke, the boys would say, when I say hi, Olaolu, and the boys would say, hi, Olaolu. And all of the boys decided to chase the light-skinned, well, you know, smoothly spoken young girls who didn't have my type of baritone voice, my type of energy and drive, the one that you assume that I'm a science student, even though I'm not. But in actual fact, you see, those rejections of my childhood, those pains, and those agonies filled my passion and helped me to come this far. First of four children, I have one brother that my mom always told me would be better than the rest of us, three girls. So the Me Too movement didn't actually start in 2016 or 17 by the women of America. It started right there in my home, where I always had to prove a point to my mom that even though I'm a girl, I'm going to be equal to 40 of the men. And I believe that this is the reality of many girls that I encounter day on day who are struggling with their own identities of wanting to be girls, of wanting to be original, of wanting to be passionate, wanting to be able to stay true to their dreams. In the faces of men who want to abuse us, in the faces of fathers who sleep with their daughters, teachers who sleep with their students, men who tell us we don't matter, political parties who simply let us wear uniform and carry and dance behind the men, when in fact the women are the engine room of those political parties. So I grew up in that kind of house, went to primary school in Ebonyi, another primary school, in Oregon. My proprietress, Mrs. Joko Tade Awoshika, has been my godmother forever. God bless her soul. I love her as equal as I love my mom. Sometimes the real people that touch your lives in the greatest way are people that are not even your blood. Are people that just simply understand your journey and understand the power of their participation in that your journey. And they are the ones who bring you to your place of purpose at the time and season that is right. Grew up in that house, went to secondary school in Lagos Model College, Kankoba, Dagri. Left there in my GS3, went to secondary school in Yewa College, Laro, just because my parents separated when I was 13 or about 14. My stepmom sent right straight from the cocoon of hell to me. Decided that I should leave the school that was the best in Lagos State for 6 consecutive years to a school in Ebado College, Laro, somewhere in the hinterland of Ogun State where there were no windows and where I was supposed to be banished into a time of my life where I would never blossom. But guess what? When I was finishing school in 1999, the Ionian group of schools, I was the best student in Ogun State in that year. And my prize when I was leaving secondary school as the best student in all subjects, an essay writing, was presented by Professor Joseph Eti, who was the personal physician to President Obasanjo at that time. So sometimes I tell you the stories because people don't tell us enough stories of failure. And I'm tired of people wanting to share the stories of the positives alone. Because sometimes you need those failures at the edge of your breakthrough so that you can push forward and break out. Sometimes you need to be given to witches in the hospital where you were born, like I was, so that God can show the efficacy of his power, that he is indeed God. And you don't kill what you did not make. After okay. And I went on to University of Jos, did, contested for deputy speaker, at the age of 19, youngest ever in that time, decided that my journey, I was studying law at the university, and then moved on to, and my second year was where I found my passion. I was just tired of old people speaking for us, went to school in the north, I'm Yoruba, and women are not supposed to speak up, so I decided to test my popularity and run, and I won. And I ran against my senior, was in a 400 level class, and I won 44 votes to 22 of our own. And that's the first time I learned to write a letter to my opponent, congratulating them for running against me and showing me how much I needed to work hard to prove myself and get everything I deserve in life on merit, on my own strength, not because I had connections or anybody standing right behind me. Now, I moved on from university and then after school. My third year, I started to publish Rise magazine, which was specifically focused on youth and education development. And therefore, I came to Lagos. And during that time, I started to interview a lot of personalities. I can't tell you my entire story in 10 minutes like I've been given, but I'll share the highlights. The rest are on the internet, and I'm happy to chat with you after we finish this evening. And afterwards, I started Rise Networks. And perhaps one of the most important things that have happened to me in my career that validated me the most. Because I remember that when I got a job in Owando, back in school when I was in student government, I met someone called Orede Jidelam, who was company secretary of Owando, and had offered me a job when I graduated, in the legal department of Owando. And you know the dream of every young person is to work for an oil company. So my mom, was so excited after she had sold a microwave and dishes to pay my school fees as a single parent. And 3 months later, I walked out of that job. And she stood on the roof of our house reading courses on me downstairs. But I realized that some jobs bring you comfort and convenience. Some other jobs bring you real significance. The kind of jobs you do that help you touch the life of other people, that help you speak for the people that can't speak for themselves, that help you to be able to speak through to a government that do not understand that the power in the people are greater than the people in power. And that's how my journey started. And I started to work in youth and education development. That's what I've done for the most part of my career. A couple of years ago, I decided that education must become a front burner issue for Nigeria, because I'm worried about the fact that companies that focus on sponsoring reality shows instead of youth empowerment programs forget that it is illiterate young people that will work in those companies that they currently are working. Because when you are in a country where you pay teachers less than politicians, in a country where the people who do the work don't get the reward for the work they do, where our leadership recruitment system is faulty, unaccountable, and unsustainable. In a country where politicians are the ones who determine the outcomes of everything, and we have no leaders. In a country where Bill Gates says to us that he spent $1.6 billion in the northern economy and has not seen any results. Where we live in a country where young people consistently clamor for youth involvement so that they can go into power and take their own share of the national cake. Youth, the force of today, is the theme of this event. But I totally disagree when we simply want to run on the strength of youth. Because youth is simply a state of pending responsibility. The most useless governor in this country today is a young person. He's the youngest governor in Nigeria. And so I don't believe that young people must simply go into power because we are young. We must be given the opportunity to run for office and get the opportunity to sit at the table because we have character, competence, and capacity. You see a Nigeria where we have the highest debt from. You see a country where young boys have more promising futures than university graduates. A country where pizza delivery is faster than our police emergency response. If you agree with me, let me see your hands up. If you agree with me, say whoa.
Whoa.
Exactly. Because we cannot separate the fact that we need woe in our lives to keep us happy while we are dealing with the scourge of unemployment and the 110 girls that were stolen by criminals and terrorists in Dachi. I sit on the Presidential Committee of the Victims of Terrorism Support Fund, and the stories that you guys hear in the south part of Nigeria about the crisis going on in the north is nothing compared to the actual problem, to the actual crisis of kidnapping and terrorism. In actual fact, I went to Yola, Michika Madagali local government, with my 7-month-old pregnancy last October. And there are parts of the north. I drove 5 hours on the worst roads I've ever driven, even though I went to school in the north. But there are parts of Nigeria where Boko Haram has already put their own flags and taken over territories of Nigeria, have been considered to terrorists already. We cannot continue like this and keep talking about youthism. Omadeoke, Foyoluju. It is so important that our generation learn that genuflecting and cowering to the older people is not a sustainable strategy. That being special advisor and special assistant is low and beneath what you deserve as a young person who went to university. That you are more competent than your local government chairman and that senator that represents your constituency. That your participation in politics is beyond just voting and walking away back into your air-conditioned rooms. When in fact, the people that are going to win are going to make sure that your children, the first things that they learn is never don't bring light. We cannot continue to stay stuck in the rut. I'm 34, so in another couple of months, I won't be young anymore. And I'm glad and blessed to see the next generation of leaders in this room. But you guys aren't going to lead if you don't learn to ask questions. We must embrace a country that embraces consequences. A country where people steal and serve jail terms. A country where people who have oppressed us and put us where we are today. A country where people deliberately refuse to give us the kind of education we deserve so that we cannot have the right rational thinking to ask them questions. Dr. Ogunsanya lived in a great country. And they are quick to quickly tell us about how the Yakubu Gowons and the Matthew Boos and the Patutomis rose to power in their 20s and their 30s. Well, guess what, young people? Nobody gives us opportunities. Nobody gives us chance. If we're able to replicate the success, the biggest investment of Mark Zuckerberg in Nigeria, in the world today, is in a Nigerian company called Andela, $24 million. And when Mark Zuckerberg came to Nigeria, he didn't go to Aso Rock or go to the governor's office. He went to Yaba, where young people built with sweat and blood without the involvement and investment of government. That is the power that young Nigerians have. Our power is not in our numbers. We are in the 70%. The power is not in our numbers. The power is in what we do with the numbers, guys. The power is not in these statistics of 65 million, 70 million young people, because the young people of today would be the adult tomorrow. And we cannot face today's challenges with yesterday's knowledge. So if you don't read, and all you have going for you is Instagram and Facebook, and you stay chasing girls, and for the girls, you stay sleeping with other people's husbands. Because it's true that you do. Your moral values will not be anywhere different from the kind of person you will be when you eventually get in a leadership position. But I've also learned that you can make a difference out of political office. You do not have to be elected into an office. But I know the rich people like the Sultan of Brunei and Bill Gates. And I know Steve Jobs. And I've heard of Aliko Dangote. But guess what? The people we never forget are the people who do work that they don't live to see. The people who build trees so that children in 50 years can come and sit under them. The Mother Teresa's of this world. And the Martin Kings of this world. The Campos Awamas of this world. The Fumilayaras of Kutis of this world. What work would you do, guys, that this kind of conversation in 20 years will not be happening? When we talk about youth, the it will be that those young people have education, have privilege, do not cower to politicians, do not sell their votes, and they completely resist the establishment. And as I close, please do note that we cannot outsource our critical thinking to God. We cannot outsource our critical thinking to donors, multilateral agencies, and religious leaders, and traditional rulers that have sold us out already. We cannot be politically active only once in election year. We must understand that as young people, the Bible says that the people without vision will perish. And the Bible also tells me that it is young people that we have the vision. And your vision is not what you do with your eyes, it is what you do with the eyes of your mind. And therefore, the privilege of sitting here and speaking to you is not because in any way I'm better than you are. It's because I'm angry, you're angry, but I'm doing something about my own anger. I thank you. My name is Toyosi.